Welcome to Lutheran Church of the Holy Spirit Worship Online, and thank you for continuing to invite us into your home each week. If this service is helpful to you or someone you know, you can help spread the good news with others by simply clicking the like and share button on your YouTube or your Facebook feed. Thank you also for the gifts that you send to this ministry, Lutheran Church of the Holy Spirit. If each gift brings us an opportunity to carry out our mission in this community and in the world just a little better. Now I'd like to invite you to light a candle in your space as a visible sign of the Holy Spirit's presence in your home, in our midst, and in the world in which we are called to serve. In the waters of the River Jordan, Jesus is revealed as the beloved Son of God. Through this epiphany, Jesus fulfills the ancient prophecy and is christened the servant of God who will bring forth justice and equity to all people.
In the waters of baptism, we too are washed clean, anointed by the Spirit, named God's beloved children, and instructed to follow Jesus' ministry.
Beloved of God, you have not received a spirit of destruction and chaos. You have received the Spirit of God. Behold, my people whom I uphold, my chosen ones in whom my soul delights, I have given my Spirit to you.
The Spirit of God changes us. We see the world as God's beloved creation. We see all of humanity as God's beloved children. We see our hearts as God's home.
Receive the promises of baptism. You are God's child. And through the waters of baptism, you are redeemed and anointed for service to all people.
Behold, my people whom I behold, my chosen ones in whom my soul delights, I have given my Spirit to you. Amen.
Immerse us in your grace, mark us with your images, and raise us to live our baptismal vows empowered by the Holy Spirit and the example of Christ.
Amen. Our first reading for today comes from Isaiah chapter 43. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Ascribe to the Lord, you gods.
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due God's name.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunder.
The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice.
The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar tree.
The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
O Lord, give strength to your people.
Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace.
Our gospel today comes from the third chapter of the Gospel of Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As the people were filled with expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John the Baptist, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, no, to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, you are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The baptism of Jesus. Do we ever take a good look at this event, or do we simply chalk it up as something that happened? Done, finished, and let's move on. A good place to start, of course, is with the story that we just heard. We heard the first part of this story just a few weeks ago. Remember how John was at the Jordan River, where generations before the people of Israel crossed into the Promised Land. And John, the prophet, the Baptist, was preaching about repentance and about judgment. He talked about useless chaff and how it would be burned with unquenchable fire. He was kind of a fire and brimstone kind of character, this John. And it was in this place and in this context that Jesus came to be baptized. It's worth mentioning that our basic understanding of baptism comes from Jesus and from what happened at Jesus' baptism and from what happened after and because of his baptism, period. The first thing I want to point out is that when Jesus was baptized, no one told him what to do. John the Baptist didn't tell him what to do, and John, we know, was more than happy to tell absolutely everyone else, including the king, exactly what to do, but not Jesus. And God, the Creator, didn't tell Jesus what to do either. Notice that. The Creator told Jesus who he was.
You are my beloved, you are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased. But there's nothing in there about what Jesus was supposed to do, about what it looked like for him to be the beloved, or about how to live out that identity that was revealed to him. It seems that Jesus works this out himself. So let's take a look at some of the options and the expectations that were in front of Jesus as he decided what it would mean for him to be chosen, beloved Messiah. Remember, Jesus was a real person who had to make real decisions. He isn't simply a puppet or God, the creator in flesh, because Jesus lived in this, in his particular world and in his particular community. He was surrounded by a variety of traditions and expectations of what it meant to be Messiah, the beloved. Now, you got to hang with me, because many of these visions, traditions, and expectations are still with us today. And lots of folks are still pretending that Jesus chose one or the other of these different options and not the one that Jesus did choose. In fact, he did choose one option. After Jesus was named the beloved of the Creator, here are some of the places that he could have looked to determine what this meant. First, he could have looked up and he could have seen John the Baptist, the modeled beloved after and modeled this beloved thing after him. Jesus could have lived a rigid, ascetic life, ignoring or disdaining physical and social pleasures. He could have preached a rigorous moralism, worn weird clothes and eaten odd food, and promised that if you were not good, God would get you good. Well, Jesus, like John the Baptist, could have confined his ministry to the people of Israel and waited for the wrath to come. A lot of people thought that the Messiah would be like that. In fact, a lot of people thought that John was the Messiah precisely because he did these things. Jesus could have looked there. Or he could have looked at the headlines and the issues of the day and become an anti-Roman agitator, allied perhaps with the zealots who pretty much invented guerrilla warfare, or with one of the other nationalist parties of his time. He could have organized an army and set out to restore to God's people their rightful heritage by might and by warfare. Many who claimed to be the Messiah, or who were considered to be the Messiah, did exactly that with different levels of success. He could have promised military victory, economic prosperity, and national greatness. This was probably the most common expectation at the time. Most everybody believed this was what the Messiah was going to do. And of course, within a generation, Palestine was in full military revolt against Rome. Jesus could have followed this route. Or he could have looked to the Hebrew text, our Old Testament. He could have chosen one of its many and varied images of what those books say it looks like to be the beloved of the Creator. He could have gone to the Book of Kings and taken David or Solomon, the great kings of ancient Israel, as his model. They were stellar soldiers and politicians, players on the international scene, and they remained to Jesus' day symbols and constant reminders of Israel's past greatness as an independent nation and world power. People wanted those good old days back, and lots of them expected the Messiah to bring them back. Or Jesus could have looked at the book of Daniel and its apocalyptic vision of God's triumph, where God suddenly and unambiguously appears in history and brings one horrible trial after another on all of creation until the evil are clearly and decisively defeated and destroyed, and the chosen are given a whole new creation as the old one passes away. This was also a popular hope among a number of small but very influential religious groups that Jesus knew about and that knew about Jesus. Or he could have turned to Haggai or another of the lesser prophets. They saw the Messiah as the one to purify Israel, to destroy the Gentiles, to cleanse and perfect the temple and its sacrifices, to bring about right worship and study, and to create a racially and religiously pure community. Those were just a few of the choices. There are lots and lots more back in Jesus' day. All of these were popular visions of the Messiah in Jesus' day, and there were self-styled messiahs who modeled themselves on each and every one of them. In fact, these options are still with us today. There are more than a few who want and who pretend that Jesus and the church are really all and only about preaching morality or causing social reform or gaining personal prosperity or bringing in renewed national greatness or bringing back the good old days or just hanging around until God brings down the whole shebang in one great explosion or creating the perfect, pure, and isolated community, a group of homogeneous as it is holy. All of these are still around today. Just like they were around in Jesus' day. They are all temptations for me, for you, for us, as they were for Jesus and all of those people in Jesus' time. But Jesus chose none of them. None of these did Jesus choose. Guided by that Spirit he received at his baptism, Jesus did go to the Bible for his vision of what it meant to be the beloved of the Creator, but he went to a generally ignored and fairly obscure part of the Bible, to a part that no one up until then had really much bothered with. He went to the servant songs of the prophet Isaiah, four powerful and perplexing poems. The part of Isaiah that we just heard is right in the middle of these perplexing poems. In these passages, God's chosen one is portrayed not as a king or a conqueror, but as a servant, weak, gentle, patient, and burdened with pain. A servant. He is a servant who somehow, mysteriously, and through his obedient suffering, redeems not only Israel, but all of humanity. And in these passages, the servant of God, the beloved, fulfills none of the popular expectations of a Messiah. Instead, he embraces a faithful obedience that leads to a different kind of victory. It's no accident that the church insists that we hear these readings from Isaiah during Christmas, during Epiphany, and during Holy Week. When Jesus came up out of the waters of baptism, he was given his identity just like we are at our own baptisms. He was named Beloved of God, just like we are, you and I. He had to decide where to look to discover how he was to live out that identity. And there were lots of options, and there still are. And so, once again, we are called to reaffirm our own baptismal covenant. And we do this to remind us that we are named Beloved of God, and we get to live this belovedness out each day. What does that look like? Jesus chose the image of servant, the one who gives up everything for the sake of faithful obedience to God's word in action. And I'll be the first to confess, I'm never going to get this servant thing the way that Jesus did. And I, and you, all of us together, each of us, are still named Beloved of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
By the Holy Spirit, you gather your church and send it out on mission to share the good news of your love. Inspire your faithful people to be fervent in prayer and service, that all people may know that they are precious in God's sight. God of grace,
hear our prayer. Establish among the nations the blessing of peace. Raise up leaders who will protect vulnerable people in their care. Strengthen advocates who risk reputation or retaliation for the sake of mercy and justice. God of grace,
hear our prayer. You protect us amidst the fires and troubles of life. Assure us that we are not alone, and we cannot be cut off from you by any illness, anxiety, or despair. God of grace,
hear our prayer. Today we pray for Mark, Jim, Chris, Roy, Lil, and all we name now with our lips or in our hearts. God of grace,
hear our prayer. You created all people in your image. We give thanks for those who have completed their baptismal journeys and now find solace in your peace. Comfort us in grief and release us from fear. God of grace,
hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
And now may God, who created you for love, who rejoices over you, and who calls you by name, may this God bless your going out and your coming in today and forever.
Amen. Go in peace to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.